Hey everybody, I hope you're having a great day. Today I want to talk to you about what's been blowing up the internet and television for the last few days, and that is the Tucker Carlson Putin interview. What I find very interesting and kind of sad is the fact that so many people have commented on this interview and have admitted that they haven't watched the full interview from start to finish. I've watched that whole interview twice. Now you may think that's kind of overkill because it's 2 hours and 7 minutes long. But I think it's very important to really understand what was going on there. Regardless of whether you think that Putin was lying during the interview, I think it's important to have heard what he has to say. Is he a master propagandist? Is he a master manipulator? Yes. Yes, he is. He was a KGB officer. He was an intelligence officer. So he does know how to manipulate people, to propagandize, and all of that. But does that mean we shouldn't listen to him? We can evaluate what he said and how he said it, but we can't do that unless we listen to him. And he does have a certain perspective that we should hear out. The best lies have some basis in truth. Now, also there was a lot of criticism about how the interview was a softball interview, that there wasn't any really hard questions. And from my perspective, I think Tucker actually did a really good job. His job is not to get Putin to say something that Putin doesn't want to say. That's an interrogation, not an interview. So much of today's interviews in the media are about getting clicks, getting views, being confrontational. It's about entertainment. It's not about getting someone to give their side of the story. That's what interviews should be. When you're interviewing somebody in a police setting, there's two types of interviews. There is an interview, and then there's an interrogation. An interrogation is when you try to get somebody to give you information they don't want you to have, or that is not necessarily flattering to their point of view. And I can tell you that being confrontational to that person is not necessarily the best way to do it. That is kind of a Hollywood thing. The good cop, bad cop, or coming in slamming the table and demanding that they tell the truth and intimidating the witness doesn't get it done. Building a rapport with the person that you're interrogating often does. But in a journalistic interview, that's really not the case. Getting someone to admit to something that they don't want to admit to is really not the point of a journalistic interview. A journalistic interview is giving somebody the opportunity to give their side of the story. And if it presents that they are lying, you've given them the rope to hang themselves with later. So you evaluate what's happened later, and you can bring up the fact if they contradict facts during the interview, fine, bring that up if you deem that it's important. But if you get too hostile to an interviewer, especially in a journalistic sense, when they don't have to be there, they can call off the interview, they can walk out, and then what do you have? You have entertainment value, but you don't have anything of substance. That's what news is today. A lot of times it's entertainment value without a lot of substance, and that's why a lot of people are gravitating towards non-traditional media sources. What I found also very kind of funny, disturbing, whatever, is the reaction prior to the interview being released. Hillary Clinton, for example, went on the NBCSN, I think it was, and she said, well, Putin's a liar, and Tucker is a useful idiot. What good does that do? And how does she know anything about what's going to be revealed in this interview? She doesn't. She wanted to get out in front of it, and she wanted to influence how people viewed this interview even before the interview was conducted. The only value that that had was to say, hey, is Hillary Clinton being reasonable? Is she disingenuous towards this whole process? And I think it came off that way. Because regardless of what you think of Tucker and regardless of what you think of Putin, if we stop listening to people and opposing points of view, then we will never get together on any issue at all. And that's not the purpose of politics, it's not the purpose of the media, it's not the purpose of communicating effectively. The purpose of all of those things is to listen to the other point of view, decide for yourself what is real, what is truthful, what you accept. Not to blindly say, well, this goes against my perspective, my beliefs, so I'm not going to listen to it at all. That doesn't do anybody any good. One of the things that came out of the Putin interview, and I am going to delve into some of the points that I found interesting, but one of the things I found interesting is how many people thought that the first 30 minutes was completely useless and they skipped over it. Regardless of whether it's relevant or not to why Putin invaded the Ukraine, it does give you background and it does give you a sense of where Putin is coming from. Why that motivated him to go into the Ukraine, it may not be relevant at all, but he does give a perspective of the history of the Ukraine, how he believes it is part of Greater Russia. And what I found kind of interesting is the definition of Ukraine in Russia being the hinterlands, or the outlying area, the border area. I found that kind of interesting. I never knew that before. Yeah, I listened to this whole interview twice. I don't know too many people who've done that. Maybe a lot of people have. But I listened from start to finish. When you start jerry-picking what you're even listening to, then how are you going to determine what is important and what isn't? I don't think that first 30 minutes has a lot of relevance as to why he invaded the Ukraine. Because we know that the Ukraine is an independent country. It has been recognized as an independent country, and we accept that it should be an independent country. So now we have to go into why he invaded. Most of us in the West, I think, at least I did, maybe I'm the only one, I don't know, but I think that a lot of people in the West thought that it was expansionary desires, that he wanted to expand his reach, bring back the old Soviet socialist republic. Now he refuted that, whether it's true or not, he refuted that. He said that his basic reason for invading the Ukraine, in his words, were to stop a war that began in 2014. I was not aware that there was a war happening, and I don't think it was a war in the traditional sense of war, but that was his ultimate excuse for going in, as well as denazification. What was kind of interesting about denazification is I had really not heard that term being used before. It's kind of self-explanatory. And he went into detail about how the Ukraine leadership was aligning themselves with neo-Nazis. And I was not aware of that. I absolutely was not aware of that. He brought up the embarrassing incident in Canada in the Canadian Parliament. So the Prime Minister's office invited this former Nazi to to Parliament, and Parliament stood up, accepted him as a freedom fighter for the Ukraine, and with President Zelensky of the Ukraine stood up and gave this person a standing ovation. And then later they found out that he was an SS officer. The funny thing is we know that we knew ahead of time, or they knew ahead of time, that he had been in the German army. Well, who was fighting in the German army during World War II? People who were fighting against Russia, people who were also fighting against the Allied, and Russia was essentially an ally of the West. So they're honoring a person who was fighting for the Nazis, regardless of whether they knew he was in the SS or not. He was in the German army at the time. They were honoring him in the Parliament of Canada. One could argue maybe he was a conscript. I don't know. It turns out that he couldn't have been because he was in the SS. But if they believed he was a conscript, then why are they honoring him for fighting against the Russians? Because it wasn't his choice. So they honored him because it was his choice to fight against the Russians, an ally of the West during World War II. He was fighting for Germany, which were Nazis. I can't emphasize how stupid the Prime Minister's office and Parliament in whole looked after that. They didn't think it through. Clearly, they did not think it through. So let's get back to denazification. But according to Putin, Zelensky was aligning himself with neo-Nazis and that they were fighting against Russians, people of Russian descent, which, according to Putin, Ukraine is ethnic Russian. And he went into a long talk about the history of the Ukraine, the history of Russia and stuff. And I said before, I don't think it's really relevant to his invasion, but it is interesting background to see how he thinks, or at least how he reports to think. So according to Putin, in this interview, there was a war happening at the time. He went in to stop the war and to effect denazification. So this is stuff that I had not really thought about. I hadn't really followed the war prior to the invasion, and really all of what I had consumed from the media about the war was from after February 2022 and from the mainstream media. And I think that it was actually quite limited in what we got. And one of the things that was brought up was our attention span in the West. So we tune into whatever news we're listening to, whether it be on the internet or whether it be on television. And if it's more than 30 seconds, maybe a minute, maybe 2 minutes, we kind of tune out. We lose interest. So how do we expect to understand the depth of the situation in the Ukraine if our attention span is that limited? And I got from a lot of analysis that this was a huge, lengthy interview. It was 2 hours. I've conducted interviews. Of course, they were in a different setting. There were police interviews. I've conducted interviews longer than 2 hours. And I didn't find that I was tuning out of this interview that Tucker did with Putin. Yes, it was, I think for a lot of people, kind of slow moving and was very detailed, and people were losing interest. I didn't lose interest. Not that I believed everything Putin said, although there were a lot of things he said that are verifiable and did happen, but I did find that it was interesting because it is essentially the perspective of an enemy. When you stop listening to the enemy, I think you've done yourself a grave disservice, because now you don't know how the enemy is thinking, or how the enemy is trying to get other people to think. So you got to listen to the enemy, and you got to, even if they're lying, you got to listen to them. You can analyze if they're lying later, but it's important to listen. When you listen to a lot of the analysis of this interview, you'll find people bringing out the points that they think are relevant and very interesting and will lead to a further understanding of this war and conflict and how to end it. The things that I got out of this interview that I thought was important, that I think should be relevant to everybody's decision-making process, are the following. First, I really was not aware of the coup in 2014. Maybe I was asleep at the wheel, doesn't matter. I was not aware of that situation. I was aware of a lot of the scandals that were reported at the time of the 2016 election and also the 2020 election. Belief that some people have that there were illegal actions and dishonest actions by the then Vice President of the United States in order to get the Ukrainian prosecutor to stop investigating. I was also aware that Joe Biden's son, Hunter Biden, had been on some board of some oil company in the Ukraine, and the opinion of a lot of people that he wasn't qualified. He was only on that board in order to have influence with the then Vice President. Is that true? I can't say, but I was aware of that controversy. I was not aware that there had been a coup. And I don't think that Putin lied about that, because it could be verified. You don't lie about something that can absolutely be verified and discounted. You just don't. It doesn't make any sense. Now, if he did lie about it, I'm sure that will come out in the days to come. But apparently it's well known. It happened. The bombing of the Nord Stream pipeline I found very interesting, because I had no idea who did it. I was aware that it happened, and I was aware that some people blamed Russia. I was not aware that a lot of people are blaming the Ukraine and the United States, the CIA. Did that happen? I don't know. But there was a part of this interview where Tucker said, well, it has come to light that Germany accepts the fact that one of their NATO partners bombed the pipeline. Is that true? I don't know. But I found that interesting, because that, I believe, could probably be verified. I found it interesting that after the Cold War, after the fall of the Union of Soviet Socialist Republic, that Russia and a lot of people in the West thought that this would be a new era of cooperation, but that never materialized. I remember at the time thinking, okay, they may not be our allies, but at least now their markets are open, now there's more economic opportunities, now there's, you know, a level of cooperation. They are now within the community of reasonable countries. I thought that at the time. But according to Putin, that never materialized. And I think that that's kind of verifiable. Maybe it materialized to a certain extent, but not to the extent that they expected. I found it interesting that after the fall of the Berlin Wall, after the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics had collapsed, that there was overtures towards the West by Russia for joint sort of military security efforts. and that those were rejected. I found it interesting that he approached President Clinton saying that, hey, would you accept us into NATO? Would that be reasonable? And that Clinton said, hey, you know, I don't see any roadblocks to that, but then he went and talked to his senior advisors, came back and said, no, can't do it. I found that interesting because NATO was formed, as we all know, after World War II, mainly in response to threats from Russia. And there's other security reasons as well, but mainly in response to threats by Russia. So now Russia is no longer the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, and now they want to join NATO. Why? What for? I found that interesting. Maybe there were really legitimate reasons for expanding NATO. One of the things I found very interesting by Putin was the claim that in 1991, he had received guarantees that NATO would not expand east of Germany. And then there were several expansions east of Germany. And one of the things he said was, well, that was never the response that he got was, it was never written down. It was never a formal agreement. We all know nations sign agreements without any intention of following through. Look at Canada's commitment to NATO, for example. Canada has committed 2% GDP to military spending. So they can have a commitment to NATO in line with all of the other nations. And a lot of the nations do not match or live up to their agreements. Canada can't. I don't think they ever had any intention of living up to 2% GDP. But they signed the agreement. So a lot of countries sign agreements they have no intention of living up to. And that was brought up in this interview as well. We also have in this interview a comment, and I think that it could be verified, that Kamala Harris had offered NATO membership to the Ukraine. That would mean the United States and NATO could then move in strategic assets into the Ukraine, which were a threat to Russia. I found the Istanbul peace talks of about 18 months ago very interesting, really interesting, because what you have here is an agreement, and I think this can be verified. So you have an agreement that the war will end. So it was a peace agreement. And then Germany and another country, I think it was France, said, hey, you can't expect that the President Zelensky will sign this agreement while they have a gun to their head. And then Putin said, well, you know, that sounds reasonable, and backed off. I knew that the Russian army was on Kiev's doorstep, and I knew that they backed off. I didn't know why they backed off. And this may not be true. This is what Putin said. Okay? Now I want to reiterate that Vladimir Putin is an ex-KGB officer, and he's a master manipulator and a master propagandist. I'm not saying he's a great guy, but I think that things like this can be verified. So is he lying? Is he not lying? It wouldn't make sense for him to lie about this. And then I found it interesting that Boris Johnson of the UK comes to Kiev and talks Zelensky out of signing this peace accord. I found that really interesting. I found it interesting that it was at the behest of the Americans. Is it true? Is it not true? I don't know, but I think that these things can be verified. So does it make sense for Putin to lie about them? I also found it very interesting that in Putin's view, or what he claims, is it's a more of a civil regional conflict. And that makes sense in his view of the area being part of Greater Russia, that it's a civil conflict, civil war. You know, this is not a war of expansion, that he doesn't have any expansionary interest, that he is not intending to go into Poland or any other country, that he would only ever consider going into Poland if Poland attacks Russia. I found that very interesting. Whether it's true or not, I don't know. So those are the interesting things that I found about this interview. And I think that they are things that the West needs to consider going forward. What does Putin think? Or what is he trying to get us to believe he thinks? Because again, he's a master manipulator and a master propagandist. Does he lie? Yes, he lies. Does he lie more than Western politicians? Well, I don't know. What I found quite disturbing afterwards is that people like Trudeau and people like Boris Johnson would go on and say, well, he's a liar and that's it. What was disturbing about those comments were that they did not specify what he was lying about. We know that politicians lie to us. It is reasonable to assume that some of what Putin said were lies. But what exactly did he lie about? What lies are he telling us? What propaganda is he trying to make us believe? That's important. Not just saying flat out, he's a liar, don't listen to him. Trudeau was very upset with Putin bringing up the Nazi in Parliament. Well, that is a known fact. He's not lying about that. That is a known fact. So don't just tell me that you think that one of the greatest liars in Canadian political history thinks that another politician is a liar. Tell me why. Tell me where he lied. I can make a lot of my own assumptions about where he lied. I can make my assumption, my own determinations that I think that his invasion, that the rationale for his invasion into the Ukraine is probably a lie. I can make those assumptions, but maybe I'm wrong about that. Tell me where he lied. Don't just blindly state, he's a liar, and that's it. Tell me where he lied in your perspective, in your view. I can come up with my own opinions, but if you're telling me as a leader of a Western nation, you're telling me he lied, you're stating that as a fact, not an opinion. I can say I have an opinion that this is misinformation, that this is a lie, and I'm golden. I can do that. That's an opinion. But as a leader of a Western democracy, to state as a fact that somebody lied, I think it's incumbent upon you to give proof of that. Because it's no longer an opinion. You're stating it as a fact. He's a liar. He lied. Prove it. Okay, I can have an opinion. I'm not a leader of a Western democracy. And so long as I say, well, I think he lied. It's my opinion that he lied. That's good. But as a leader, when you state a fact, you should be able to back it up. Not just say he's a liar and then walk off stage left. I don't think that is a valid way of conducting an interview or response to an interview. Okay, so this video is a little longer than what I hoped it would be. It's obviously not 2 hours and 7 minutes long, but it is longer than I thought it would be. I think that if you want, I think it is very important to see this video of the interview that Tucker Carlson conducted. I think it has a lot of value, whether you believe anything in it or not, whether you recognize it as being propaganda or not, an attempt to manipulate the West or not, which are probably all correct. But it is very important that if we are making judgments upon another country, and if we are engaging in what could escalate into a global conflict, I think that it's important that we understand a little bit more about the global conflict, and that we understand and listen to our enemy, and we decide for ourselves what's reasonable to believe and what isn't. You may say that, hey, this is that everything you said was completely irrational or irrelevant, and we need to go in with military force. That may be your belief and your perspective. But decide for yourself. So I hope this video has brought some perspective to you on this interview that Tucker did with Putin. I hope that you support this channel by clicking like, hitting subscribe, and I hope that you have a healthy, happy, and prosperous day.